Somewhat similar to Earth.
Yeah, similar.
I think I can pick up something visual. It's a news broadcast using a system I think they once called video.
Television was the colloquial term.
Put it on the screen.
Aye.
All I ask is a tall ship and a star to steer by.
I knew that we had something very unique, something very special. Television is not known for respecting quality. And I predicted that with luck, at best, we'll have two seasons.
That's enough.
You're trying to be funny.
Never.
We were making a show for entertainment. But at the same time, the shows were about something. They were about the Vietnam War. Or they were about any number of things that can be said in science fiction that sometimes can't be said in a straight drama.
I'm a doctor. I'm a doctor, not an escalator.
Not a bricklayer. Not a diplomat.
I always laugh when people ask me if I felt exploited in wearing the miniskirt. It was an expression of women's liberation.
All this power surging and throbbing. Are you like that, Captain?
You didn't think I had it in me, did you, Spock?
No, sir. The most significant thing that can be said
is dead, Chuck.
If you are involved in Star Trek, don't wear a red shirt.
Great adventure, great human themes, loyalty, decency, kindness, ethical questions being dealt with. Every episode hopefully would touch on a number of ideas that would grow on you if you watched the episode several times over your lifetime.
You're the captain. You haven't the right to be vulnerable in the eyes of the crew.
You broke my sword!
Fascinating.
Obviously, the Arganians aren't going to let us fight. A shame, Captain. It would have been glorious.
That was late 1960s.
Apparently, Captain, so are we.
Welcome. I'm William Shatner. In 1964, Gene Roddenberry had a simple idea. A wagon train to the stars. New pioneers exploring a new frontier. He had a vision of the future where mankind had overcome many of his problems and desired nothing more than a peaceful quest for knowledge. Well, with more imagination than money, Star Trek was a ratings failure. In fact, I think Variety said it wouldn't last. And it only lasted for three short seasons. Yet, the ideas embodied in Star Trek inspired such a passion in its fans, they would not let it die. Tonight, we'll look back at the original series. There's a familiar sight. Hear from the people who made it and explore the Star Trek phenomena and its future.
final frontier. These are the voyages of the starship Enterprise.
For the Enterprise and its crew, these words were a call to adventure. And the adventure began here. Familiar feel. It was a journey of discovery to explore strange new worlds and seek out new life and new civilizations. To boldly go where no one had gone before.
This is Captain James Kirk of the USS Enterprise. We are on a peaceful mission. We mean no harm to you or any life forms. Please communicate with us.
We're on 1,000 planets and spreading out. We cross fantastic distances, and everything's alive. Life everywhere, we estimate. There are millions of planets with intelligent life. We haven't begun to map them.
I'm in command. I could order this. But I'm not. Because Dr. McCoy is right in pointing out the enormous danger potential in any contact with life and intelligence as fantastically advanced as this. But I must point out that the possibilities, the potential for knowledge and advancement is equally great. Risk is our business. That's what this starship is all about. That's why we're aboard her.
Roddenberry, inspired by Captain Horatio Hornblower, created Captain James T. Kirk, a courageous explorer, a lover, oh yes, a skilled diplomat and a warrior philosopher.
The character of Captain Kirk very often had to carry the freight of rigidity and self-righteousness, the super responsible person. I thought it was a difficult position for him to be in.
Your ship must be destroyed. We therefore grant you 10 Earth time periods, known as minutes, to make preparations.
There must be something to do. Something I've overlooked.
Chess. When one is outmatched, the game is over. Checkmate.
Not chess, Mr. Spock. Poker. Ship to ship. This is the captain of the Enterprise. Since the early years of space exploration, Earth vessels have had incorporated into them a substance known as corbomite. If any destructive energy touches our vessel, a reverse reaction of equal strength is created, destroying...
You now have 2 minutes.
Destroying the attacker. Death has little meaning to us. If it has none to you, then attack us now.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
A very interesting game, this poker.
It does have advantages over chess.
The Enterprise's first officer, Mr. Spock, was half Vulcan and half human. As a Vulcan, he was guided by logic. As a human, he had to live with his emotionalism.
Most illogical.
I thought this was going to be a very interesting character, an interesting challenge for an actor to play this character with an internal conflict like that, being half alien, half human.
That's true. Mr. Spock, you're the most cold-blooded man I've ever known.
Why, thank you, Doctor.
What makes you right and a trained psychiatrist wrong?
Because she feels. I don't. All I know is logic.
Fascinating. Fascinating. Fascinating.
Don't say it's fascinating.
No. But it is interesting.
It's also a very human condition. Most humans deal with this internal issue all the time, this control of emotion or living with emotion or dealing with emotion versus what Spock, of course, would call logic or the intellect in general.
You must turn command over to somebody else. Only you can give your father the blood transfusions that he needs to live.
I cannot dismiss my duties.
Duty? Your duty is to your father.
I know. But this must take precedence. If I could give the transfusion without loss of time or efficiency, I would. Sarek understands my reason.
Well, I don't. It's not human. Oh, that's not a dirty word. You're human, too. Let that part of you come through. Your father's dying.
Mother, how can you have lived on Vulcan so long, married a Vulcan, raised a son on Vulcan, without understanding what it means to be a Vulcan?
Well, if this is what it means, I don't want to know.
It means to adopt a philosophy, a way of life, which is logical and beneficial. We cannot disregard that philosophy merely for personal gain.
Nothing is as important as your father's life. If being Vulcan is more important to you, then you'll stand there, speaking rules and regulations from Starfleet and Vulcan philosophy, and let your father die. And I'll hate you for the rest of my life.
Mother.
Oh, go to him now, please.
I cannot.
That was the logical, responsible thing to do. But from a human emotional position, it was very, very difficult and painful. Great source of drama. What to do? What's the right thing to do?
And you, Sarek, would you also say thank you to your son?
I don't understand.
Well, for saving your life.
Spock acted in the only logical manner open to him. One does not thank logic, Amanda.
Logic, logic. I'm sick to death of logic. Do you want to know how I feel about your logic?
Emotional, isn't she?
She has always been that way.
Indeed. Why did you marry her?
At the time, it seemed the logical thing to do.
Infinite diversity in infinite combinations. The right of peaceful coexistence for all beings is one of Star Trek's guiding principles. And what better place to have this happen than on the bridge of the Enterprise.
In many respects, the Starship Enterprise was a metaphor for Starship Earth. And when you saw the bridge of the Enterprise, you saw the makeup of all of the various kinds of people that populate the Starship Earth. You saw an African woman, an Asian man at the helm. You heard a Russian accent, a Scottish accent, an American Southern accent.
My name is McCoy. I'm a doctor. I'm just a country doctor.
Stimulants.
Doctor, you are a sensualist.
You bet your pointed ears I am.
I think that when you look at McCoy on the screen, he happens to be representative of the most human person really there. The ordinary guy that's in a bizarre kind of a situation.
Once, just once, I'd like to be able to land someplace and say, behold, I am the Archangel Gabriel.
Our resident sensualist, Dr. McCoy, could always be counted on for a quick and accurate diagnosis.
On pure speculation, just an educated guess, I'd say that man is alive.
He's dead, Jim.
She's dead, Jim.
He's dead, Jim.
Well, it got to a point where I was trying to say it in so many different ways, you know. He's dead, Jim.
She's dead, Jim.
He's dead, Captain.
He's dead, Jim.
I'd switch it around. Sometimes I'd say, Jim, he's dead.
He's dead. She's dead. He's dead.
She's dead.
We're dying.
He's dead.
She's dead. He's dead, Captain.
The Captain is dead.
And I think that's probably going to be on my tombstone when I go, he's dead, Jim.
He was worse than dead.
Come on, Bones, what's the mystery?
His brain is gone.
Richelieu, beware!
Helmsman's engine room, stand by. All decks alert. We're going to try pulling away.
I recognized right away that Sulu was a breakthrough role for an Asian character. because up until that time, television had always characterized Asian characters in stereotypes. And here was the character of Sulu that Gene was describing to me, a member of the leadership team of this starship. I was blown away by that.
Romulans approaching from both sides, sir.
Helm doesn't answer. We can't move. You either leave this bois bloodied, or with my blood on your swords.
Shields on. Phasers. Men and ready, sir.
I've been wanting to get you in a place like this for a long time.
What can I do, Captain? You know we're always supposed to maintain good relations with the natives.
They were looking for somebody who would attract the same kind of audience that the people on the monkeys had. And in actuality, they were looking initially for a young English person. I think Gene prevailed at that point and said, you know, the Russians were the first people in space, the cosmonauts, and some recognition should be made of that fact. So let's bring in a Russian who will have the appeal of the monkeys.
No debris, no residual particles, no traces.
We are programmed to function as human females, Lord.
You are?
Yes, my Lord.
This place is even better than Leningrad.
I can't give you warp 9 much longer, Mr. Spock. These engines are beginning to show signs of stress. If we keep this speed, we'll blow up any minute now.
If I push these impulse engines too hard in the condition they're in, they'll blow apart.
The emergency bypass control of the matter-antimatter integrator is fused.
Well, Scotty, now you've done it.
Aye, the haggis is in the fire for sure.
I think the Scotsmen are great engineers. You know, let's face it, they invented the steam engine, the telephone, you know, radar. Just about everything that is vitally important to us these days. Then Gene Roddenberry asked me which accent I like for an engineer, and I said, hey, you better be a Scotsman.
My bairns. My poor bairns.
Lieutenant Uhura, try to contact that ship.
Captain, I'm picking up the alien signal again.
Uhura was a wonderful character to create. Not only a woman on that bridge as part of the command crew, but a black woman. And people could look on that screen for the first time and see equality without hitting you on the head with it. The fact that I'm there was a statement.
Hailing on all frequencies, sir. All languages have been attempted. No response.
Security alert. Condition 3. All sections go to alert condition 3.
Progress report.
It's very delicate work, sir.
I can think of no one better equipped to handle it, Miss Uhura. Please proceed.
The mixture of the Enterprise's crew was immediately popular with its fans. One of the most popular crew members was my friend Michelle Nichols, who wanted to leave the series feeling that her character wasn't fulfilling its potential.
I had given it careful thought, and I went into Gene Roddenberry and told him that after the first year, I intended to leave the show. And he was very upset. That very weekend, I went to an NAACP fundraiser, and someone came to me and said, Miss Nichols, there's someone who wants to meet you. He's a great fan of yours. And I expected to turn around and see some young person, and I turned around into the face of Dr. Martin Luther King. And I was stunned, and he said, yes, I'm a big fan of yours. And I said, thank you very much. I'm very happy about that. And of course, I'm leaving the show after this first year. And he said, you cannot. And I was taken aback, and I beg your pardon. He said, don't you know who you are? Don't you know what you have? You have created a character with dignity and beauty and intelligence. He said, your most important input is for everyone who doesn't look like us, who sees us for the first time as we should be seen, as equals, as equals. In peaceful exploration, Nichelle, you cannot leave. And I was simply chilled. And I said that, thank you, Dr. King. And that Monday, when I went back to tell Gene Roddenberry what Dr. King had said, and I said to him, if you still want me to stay, I'll stay.
The real statement made by that weekly exposure to that pluralism was that that was our strength, that we have to recognize that diversity not as a problem or something that's going to divide us, but as the very thing that makes it possible for us to survive.
In a turbulent decade, as the nation dealt with war, civil unrest, and social revolution, so did Star Trek. Gene Roddenberry believed science fiction and television could be tools to communicate ideas and affect change in his world.
There's an ancient Chinese curse which says, may you live in interesting times. And we had them in the 60s. We have them now too, obviously, it hasn't stopped. But it was an extremely chaotic, difficult time and a very fertile ground for picking up metaphoric drama ideas. I think our writers captured a lot of those ideas extremely well. They were very sensitive to what was going on at the time and tried very much to bring to bear in Star Trek, in our 23rd century stories that had to do with something that was happening on Earth today that people could recognize.
It is obvious to the most simple-minded that Loki is of an inferior breed.
The obvious visual evidence, Commissioner, is that he is of the same breed as yourself.
Are you blind, Commander Spock? Well, look at me. Look at me.
You're black on one side and white on the other.
I am black on the right side. Loki is white on the right side. All of his people are white on the right side.
Doctor, you insist on applying human standards to non-human cultures. I remind you that humans are only a tiny minority in this galaxy.
There are certain absolutes, Mr. Spock, and one of them is the right of humanoids to a free and unchained environment. The right to have conditions which permit growth.
Another is their right to choose a system which seems to work for them.
This isn't life. It's stagnation.
The beautiful thing about Star Trek to me really is that it also had a moral. And maybe that's why Star Trek has lasted so long. Because everybody likes a moral story. Everybody.
No.
No, I won't kill him. Do you hear?
You surprise me, Captain.
How?
By sparing your helpless enemy, who surely would have destroyed you. You demonstrated the advanced trait of mercy, something we hardly expected. We feel that there may be hope for your kind. Therefore, you will not be destroyed. It would not be civilized.
Star Trek's writers consistently tackled difficult issues. One of our most controversial moments came in an episode called Plato's Stepchildren. Beings with telekinetic powers forced the crew to perform for their amusement, and in the process, Star Trek made television history.
I'm so frightened, Captain. I'm so very frightened.
We hardly thought anything about it, the first interracial kiss on television, because the races have been kissing since time immemorial. This was just the first time they emitted it on television. And we received more mail on that episode than we had ever received before. And Gene sent me a letter, and the letter was from a man from the South who said, I don't believe in the mixing of the races, but any time a red-blooded American boy like Captain Kirk gets a gal in his arms that looks like Lieutenant Uhura, he ain't gonna fight it. So much for the big concern over the first interracial kiss.
Perhaps audiences connected so strongly with Star Trek because it was about very human character, their friendships, and a deep sense of loyalty to one another.
Amok Time was the first episode in which we were going to deal with the Vulcan society, see some of the culture, see some of the rituals of the culture. And the plot dealt in a rather complex and very interesting, dramatic way with this issue of loyalty and friendship.
Spock, are our ceremonies for outworlders?
They are not outworlders. They are my friends.
The thing that Spock needed was to be taken to his home planet to mate. And Spock, in his terrible plaque-tau condition, which is a totally distraught and out-of-control condition when he's going through this process on Vulcan, is forced into a physical fight, a fight to the death with Kirk.
You're going to have to kill him, John. Kill Spock. That's not what we came to Vulcan for, is it?
Be careful.
Sound medical advice.
The Andu!
Get your hands off of him, Spock. It's finished. He's dead.
I grieve with thee.
And one of the most poignant moments that I ever got to play on the show was that in which I say to T'Pau, live long and prosper.
Live long, T'Pau, and prosper.
Live long and prosper, Spock.
I shall do neither. I have killed my captain and my friend.
Doctor, I shall be resigning my commission immediately, of course.
There can be no excuse for the crime of which I'm guilty. I intend to offer no defense. Furthermore, I shall order Mr. Scott to take immediate command of this vessel.
Don't you think you better check with me first?
Captain! Jim! I'm pleased to see you, Captain. You seem uninjured. I am at something of a loss to understand it, however.
Blame McCoy. That was no Triox compound he shot me with. He slipped in a neuroparalyzer. Knocked me out. Simulated death.
Indeed.
The audience saw this underlying great friendship that was there. This comradeship. I think that Star Trek touched a chord with them. It showed them that there was some place to go. There is a great future ahead of us. I think Star Trek did an awful lot of good.
There's just one thing, Mr. Spock. You can't tell me that when you first saw Jim alive, that you weren't on the verge of giving us an emotional scene that would have brought the house down.
Merely my quite logical relief that Starfleet had not lost the highly proficient captain.
Yes, Mr. Spock, I understand.
Thank you, Captain.
Of course, Mr. Spock. Your reaction was quite logical.
Thank you, Doctor.
In a pig's eye.
Come on, Spock, let's go mind the store.
Even though Star Trek was only on the air for three seasons, can you believe it? Its influence would be felt for years to come. Gene Roddenberry strove for accuracy and was in constant contact with people on the cutting edge of technological development. I heard even a Klingon or two. As a result, Star Trek predicted the development of many of the technologies commonplace today. Star Trek was right on the money with flip phones, desktop computers, and diskettes, CD-ROM players, electronic notepads, and even the military's stealth technology.
You remember the readout that was behind the hospital bed, which is commonplace today? At the time, that was far out.
Star Trek's popularity finally exploded in syndication as growing numbers discovered its message of hope.
My mail was getting heavier. The phone was ringing with requests for interviews about Star Trek. There's more and more appearance requests. And then this phenomenon of the conventions, and hundreds would show up. When hundreds were expected, thousands showed up. the show was finding an entirely new audience that it had not found in the 60s.
Well, live long and prosper.
Gene Roddenberry made numerous attempts to bring the show back as either a feature film, TV movie, or weekly series. Finally, in 1979, with the support of its devoted fans, Star Trek moved to the big screen. And once again, I sat in the captain's chair.
First as a headless.
Warp drive, Mr. Scott.
The movies not only carried on the traditions of the original series, but went quite a bit further in that we now had a much larger canvas to work on.
Fire!
The movie stayed true to Star Trek's original ideals and themes of friendship, duty, honor, and loyalty. In Star Trek II, Khan Noonien Singh, a nemesis from the original series, returned to force these issues in a powerful way.
For hate's sake, I spit my last breath at thee.
Any warp speed in 3 minutes and we're all dead.
No response, Admiral.
Scotty, get us out of here.
The good of the many versus the good of the one was a thematic idea that we dealt with a number of times in various episodes and in the films. And this became an issue of loyalty. I kept thinking about Henry V. We few, we happy few, we band of brothers. For he that sheds his blood with me today shall be my brother, be he ne'er so vile. This day shall gentle his condition.
Sir, the maids are back online.
Go, go!
Yes.
Don't grieve, Admiral. It is logical. The needs of the many outweigh
the needs of the few.
Or the one. Shall be your friend. Live long and prosper.
My friend, I can only say this. Of all the souls I have encountered in my travels, his was the most human.
In Star Trek III, our commitment to friendship compelled us to find a way to bring Spock back. Because the good of the one sometimes outweighs the good of the many.
says that you have been my friend. You came back for me.
Yes, Spock.
Jim. Your name is Jim.
Yes.
One of the issues Star Trek addressed during the 60s was the Cold War, with the Klingons representing the Soviet threat. Only the Klingons couldn't make vodka. As far back as 1967, Star Trek predicted we would have to make peace in order to survive.
You have no right to dictate to our Federation
or our Empire
how to handle their interstellar relations. We have the right
to wage war, Captain, to kill millions of innocent people, to destroy life on a planetary scale. Is that what you're defending? Oh, eventually you will have peace, but only after millions of people have died. It is true that in the future, you and the Klingons will become fast friends. You will work together.
Never!
Star Trek VI was literally torn from the headlines of the crumbling of the Berlin Wall, the breakdown of the Cold War, and are being forced to make some kind of peace, a rapprochement.
2 months ago, a Federation starship monitored an explosion on the Klingon moon Praxis. They will have depleted their supply of oxygen in approximately 50 Earth years. At the behest of the Vulcan ambassador, I opened a dialogue with Gorkon, Chancellor of the Klingon High Council.
You, Captain Kirk, are to be our first olive branch.
They are dying.
Let them die.
And then to discover that the enemy isn't always out there, that sometimes we may find it within ourselves as well.
You said it yourself, it was logical. Peace is worth a few personal risks. You're a great one for logic. I'm a great one for rushing in where angels fear to tread. We're both extremists. Reality is probably somewhere in between. I couldn't get past the death of my son. Gorkon had to die before I understood how prejudiced I was.
Is it possible that we two, you and I, have grown so old and so inflexible that we have outlived our usefulness?
Kirk finally realized that a Cold Warrior's greatest challenge was not only to make peace with his enemies, but also with himself.
Some people think the future means the end of history. Well, we haven't run out of history quite yet. Your father called the future the undiscovered country. People can be very frightened of change.
You've restored my father's faith.
And you've restored my son's.
Seems funny now that this struggling television series unhappy ending has been transformed into the opening chapter of a far bigger tale, an astonishing tale that is unsurpassed in the history of entertainment. Nothing is more certain than the fact that Star Trek's mission has just begun. The journeys of the Enterprise continue in Star Trek Generations.
Captain of the Enterprise.
That's right.
Let me tell you something. Don't let them promote you. Don't let them transfer you. Don't let them do anything that takes you off the bridge of that ship, because while you're there, you can make a difference.
Come back with me. Help me stop Sodom. Make a difference again.
Who am I to argue with the captain of the Enterprise? I take it the odds are against us and the situation is grim.
You could say that.
You know, if Spock were here, he'd say that I was an irrational, illogical human being for taking on a mission like that. Sounds like fun.
In the 25 years since the original series went off the air, Star Trek has spawned 7 feature films and 3 more television series, The Next Generation, Deep Space Nine, and Voyager. If this keeps up, your grandchildren might be watching Star Trek.
Star Trek was everything that I had hoped to be involved with as an actor in my life. Wonderful character to play, wonderful ensemble work to do, and great ideas to deal with.
I think it's very important that philosophy not remain just an ideal out there, but we incorporate it into our lives and act on it. And certainly that's part of the message of Star Trek.
To have been at Edwards Air Force Base that day, they rolled the Enterprise out with the Marine Band playing, you know, the Star Trek theme while this huge shuttlecraft comes out. And I look at Gene Roddenberry and I look at Lennon and all of us are there with the tears streaming down. Very emotional moment.
What Star Trek really stands for is man's ability to face and overcome his problems and better his world.
Captain, I have orders from Starfleet Command. We're to put back to space dock immediately to be decommissioned.
Course heading, Captain.
Second star to the right. And straight on till morning. Captain's log, stardate 9529.1. This is the final cruise of the Starship Enterprise under my command. This ship and her history will shortly become the care of another crew. To them and their posterity will we commit our future. They will continue the voyages we have begun and journey to all the undiscovered countries, boldly going where no man, where no one has gone before.